eternal life is ours. The Lord is risen. Death has met its master. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Happy Easter, all of you, and a very, very warm welcome as we gather here in church and online. Today is a day of celebration, and later in our service, we've got a little extra celebration as Julian is going to be received into the communion of the Church of England. I can't see him, but he's here, so we're very much looking forward to that. My sisters and brothers, we have journeyed together through Lent, through the difficult days of Good Friday and Holy Saturday. And now we come together to celebrate the good news of the resurrection and the hope that we have in Jesus Christ, in whom we find life and life in all its fullness. May our lives indeed be renewed, but not just for ourselves, but so that we may share in Christ's ministry and mission in our world. Let us pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Those of you gathered and joining us at home might like to light a candle to remind us of Christ's presence in our midst. As our Easter candle is lit, blessed are you, Lord our God, our Alpha and Omega, our beginning and our end. For you have raised Christ, the first fruits from the dead, to be our light and our hope. In the knowledge of his resurrection, may we follow all that is good and just and true, and through our Easter celebration, glimpse that eternal city, where there is neither light of lamp nor sun, but the eternal glory of our transformed humanity, in the mutual love of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Jesus Christ, risen Master and triumphant Lord, we come to you in sorrow for our sins and confess to you our weakness and unbelief. May the light of Christ, rising in glory, banish all darkness from our hearts and minds.
Amen.
Like Mary at the empty tomb, we fail to grasp the wonder of your presence. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Like the disciples behind locked doors, we are afraid to be seen as your followers. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Like Thomas in the upper room, we are slow to believe. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray that we may reign with the risen Christ in glory. God of glory, by the raising of your Son, you have broken the chains of death and hell. Fill your church with faith and hope, for a new day has dawned, and the way to life stands open in our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. Please do sit down for our readings.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Let us listen for the word of the Lord. On this mountain the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-matured wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-matured wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord of God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, "Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." For the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Let us listen for the word of the Lord. Then Peter began to speak to them. "I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all." That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did in both Judea and Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. For the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the Gospel of the Lord. I speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. I wonder what it was that drove Mary Magdalene to the tomb on that Sunday morning. Did grief at the loss of her Lord take her to visit one last time? Was the sense of loss so deep that she felt she could not leave just yet? Is that what drove her back? Was she expecting the worst, that someone might steal the body? Had she woken in the night fearing this, as she also faced the other thoughts no doubt raging through her mind in the early hours? What were you expecting, Mary? What were you expecting to do? You knew that the tomb was covered with a stone. Were you thinking you could move it by yourself? Was it the desire to just be present in the same space, to hold vigil? Was it too early to let go? Was it love that drove you to the tomb, love for your Lord and friend? And after you ran to tell the others your fear, you came back with them and you watched. You watched as they entered the tomb. You saw Peter's fear and confusion and the other disciples' faith. What made you stay when they ran? Was it love that made you stay? Who do you follow, Mary? Peter's confusion or the other disciples' faith? Then, in a tender moment, John paints the picture for us. The empty tomb, the two angels, the folded linen, and still Mary thinks the body is not there. Perhaps it has been stolen. And then her name is called. Ah, then. That beautiful moment when she hears her name called. Perhaps it was whispered, Mary. Perhaps it was called out with conviction, Mary. Her eyes are then opened, and her heart becomes alive. She sees, she believes. She who has been searching is herself found. Being called by her name moves her from conviction that Jesus is dead to now believing he is alive. Like Jesus' words before in John, likened as the Good Shepherd, he will call people by their name. Jesus calls Mary. In John's Gospel, we see that faith is not simply about the things of the resurrection, seeing an empty tomb, the angels, the linen wraps. All those are there, but yet faith is not discovered, at least for some. But it is made. The resurrection is made visible by Jesus in the encounter and in the calling of a name. And like Mary, millions of others throughout the generations will also hear their name called. Thomas, Peter, Saul, and on through the generations to come. And now, and only now, will they know the resurrection by the encounter with the living Jesus. That encounter is still true today. Meeting the risen Jesus is still the moment of the resurrection for us. Jesus calling her name is calling her something deeper into her, as all of us feel that experience, that movement within. Echoing maybe the words of Isaiah 43, do not fear, for I have freed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. You are precious in my eyes and honored, and I love you. I wonder what it means for you when you hear those words. On this day, the 4th of April in 1968, at 1 minute past six in the evening, Martin Luther King was shot and killed. 1 week at that year before Easter. One evening, a few years before, sitting at his kitchen table after receiving a death threat, he wrote, I had to know God for myself. In that moment of threat to my life, I could hear an inner voice saying to me, Martin Luther, stand up for righteousness, stand up for justice, stand up for truth, and lo, I will be with you even until the end of the world. And his ministry went on to see many in the black community in the States hear their name being called into works for justice and equality and begin the journey of being included. And those in the white majority institutions, including some of those churches, were being called out because of their racism and prejudice. And this journey continues today. And sadly, we hear the names of George Floyd, Rayshon Charles, and many like them with a knee on their neck. And we still read of and hear about institutions still being blinded by prejudice. Jesus is continuing to call names of those who've been excluded. Yes, sadly, even from people within his church. He is continuing to call all those who feel rejected because of their sexuality and who they love. He is continuing to call those who felt rejected because they don't fit in. He is still calling those who feel they are worth nothing because of the colour of their skin or the accent of their voice. He is calling those society pushes to the edge, be they refugees or asylum seekers. He is still calling. Do not fear, for I have freed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. You are precious in my eyes and honoured, and I love you. Christ is calling us by name to be a radical example of his love, loving with creative healing action, loving with gentle and welcoming words, and he's calling even before we recognize him as the risen Christ. He sees us first before we see him. We are found before we find him. The process of the resurrection begins before we're aware that it's even happening. Before we feel anything at all, maybe in the numbness of our grief, we find ourselves moving physically or spiritually toward a new horizon. Nothing seems different at first. In the challenges of our day, be it the pandemic or the ways in which we've seen dehumanizing of people in our communities, in our own sense of loss and lostness, we are called to see and believe that new life is now beginning. Like the seed planted into the ground, we wait for the growth to be seen. We may not see it happening, but it's happening. The roots are finding their way. It will be growing soon. So in us, so in our society, in our world, we must believe we are moving toward the light of the resurrection. On that first dawn, things have changed before anyone has noticed. We pray for eyes of faith and the heart of faith and the works of faith to see with Mary and the disciples that difference and change and reality in our lives and in our world. Mary's driven to be an apostle to the apostles, to announce the resurrection of Jesus. We are being called and driven today to be examples of life and love. Hear your name being called. Respond in faith. Open eyes. See the risen Son. Follow him. Believe and be love. Amen. champion to come to the front of the church as we conduct this part of the service in which we receive Julian into the communion of the Church of England. It's a bit long-winded, but sounds very sanctimonious, but it's a wonderful moment in which we recognise your faith, Julian, and your desire to be part of the Anglican Church. So please respond when I ask you the questions. You can take your mask off. You won't turn around and face everyone. And you can turn around now to me. And so I ask you, Julian, have you been baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit? Are you ready with your own mouth and from your own heart to affirm your faith in Jesus Christ? In baptism, God calls us out of darkness into his marvelous light. To follow Christ means dying to sin and rising to new life with him. Therefore, I ask you, do you reject the devil and all rebellion against God? Do you renounce the deceit and corruption of evil? Do you repent of the sins that separate us from God and neighbour? Do you turn to Christ as Saviour? Do you submit to Christ as Lord? Do you come to Christ, the way, the truth, and the life? Sisters and brothers, I ask you to profess together with Julian the faith of the Church. Please stand. Do you believe and trust in God the Father?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of the Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Julian, you are here to be received into the communion of the Church of England. Do you acknowledge the Church of England as part of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church? Do you accept the teaching, discipline, and authority of the Church of England?
I do.
Will you take part with us in worship and mission? Normally we would then go to the font, but these days perhaps it's more sensible to use holy water sprinkled on you, Julian. Almighty God, we thank you for our fellowship in the household of faith with all who've been baptized in your name. Keep us faithful to our baptism, so make us ready for that day when the whole creation shall be made perfect in your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
God of mercy and love, by one Spirit we have all been baptized into one body and made to drink of the one Spirit. We thank you for the gifts you have given to these your servants as we gather here and to Julian, for the building up of the body of Christ. Grant that they may continue in the life of the Spirit and walk with us in the light and obedience of Christ. By the same Spirit, fill the whole church with your overflowing love. Give us knowledge and discernment of your will and steadfastness in your service until we all come to the unity of the faith, to the full measure of stature of Christ, through whom we make our prayer. Amen. Amen. Julian, we recognize you as a member of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church And we receive you into the communion of the Church of England in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Together we pray. Defend, O Lord, these your servants with your heavenly grace, that they may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until they come to your everlasting kingdom. Amen. We welcome you, Julian. Perhaps with a small round of applause.
Lord, we rejoice together at this time of resurrection and new life. We are glad and grateful to be able to come together in growing ways to praise you and to revel in the community of your love. This day we are especially grateful for Julian as he joins us and your people worldwide. Today the chill wind of this time is now only background noise, with the beauty of the blossoming trees, the carpets of flowers, the bird song, and the promise of a new beginning. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, words from the resurrection hymn remind us of our journey through this year and of your promise. Now the green blade rises from the buried grain, wheat that in the dark earth many years has lain. When our hearts are saddened, grieving, or in pain, by your touch you call us back to life again. Fields of our hearts that dead and bare have been, love is come again, like wheat that springs up green. May we be like that grain touched by your love after so many months in the wilderness of loneliness, of illness, of loss, of our own inadequacies, mistakes, and questions. Help us to grow like the green blade, strong in your love, illuminated by your light, ready to take part in building a new world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, in this time of restrictions, we've had more time alone and even learned to be afraid of the touch of others. As our lives begin to open up to the outside world, show us how to draw nearer to you, in spite of and because of the bustling world around us. Help us to look more carefully at that world, at the cracks and fissures papered over, at the realities of racism, at the lived experiences of class divisions. Open our eyes and hearts to the needs of others, to the struggle for a fairer society, to finding a shared language and respect for each other. Let us also make time and find ways to love and to be loved. For what is the meaning of Christ on the cross, if not his example of limitless love? Give us strength to act in your love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for all those in special need these days, for the ill, the lonely, those who have lost friends or family members, those who feel unable to cope. We pray for those who care for us, for all medical staff, doctors and nurses, carers, technicians, cleaners, administrators, and the many working unseen. We thank you and pray for strength for our leaders at St. Barnabas, for John, for Liz, for Rachel and Katie, for Faiza, our wardens, for Chris and the choir, for the many more who support the life of the church. Lord, in your mercy, hear. And Lord, we also pray, of course, for our world and our community leaders. We pray for the Syrian people and other victims of the many ongoing wars, for the Uyghurs and other persecuted peoples whose suffering continue, for the Rohingya refugees and others suffering from destruction of their homes and even their temporary havens. Lord, we pray too for the young people dying on our streets and for their families. Help us and give us courage to find ways to stem this destruction of life and the terrible consequences for all. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear.
On this Easter day, this celebration of our risen Christ, we begin afresh with the knowledge that nothing can separate us from your love. We thank you for this day, for your love, the love of the Alpha and the Omega, our beginning and our end, the light and the hope that shines within and through us, the promise that with death comes new life, that you are with us to the end of the age. Hallelujah. Amen.
Accept these prayers for the sake of
your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Please stand. The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then they were glad when they saw the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. The peace of the risen Christ be always with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of Christ's peace, saying, "Christ is risen. He is risen indeed." Peace be with you. Christ is risen.
Thank you.
Lord of life, with unbounded joy, we offer you our sacrifice of praise. As we are fed with the bread of heaven, may we know your resurrection power. Through Christ our risen Lord. Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Almighty and Eternal Father, and on this day of our redemption to celebrate with joyful hearts the memory of your wonderful works. For by the mystery of his passion, Jesus Christ, your risen Son, has conquered the powers of death and hell and restored in men and women the image of your glory. He has placed them once more in paradise and opened to them the gate of eternal life. And so in the joy of this Passover, earth and heaven resound with gladness, while angels and archangels and all the powers of creation sing forever the hymn of your glory. You are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who on the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me."
Jesus Christ is Lord.
Lord, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. You are the Saviour of the world. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send your Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. Rejoicing in God's new creation, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. Lord, our hearts hunger for you. Give us this bread always. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. God's holy gifts for God's holy people. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father.
Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that
just a couple of notices. First, to say that this evening at Christ Chapel at 6:30, there is Evensong. You would need to book if you would like to go to that service. And secondly, to say that this morning, when it was barely light, three members of the clergy were seen poking around in the garden at the front of church. Why was this? Yes, my friends, we hid chocolate eggs. There were 200 chocolate eggs hidden in the garden at the front. After the service, and not before we say go, we can get really grumpy, us clergy. Not before we say go, you are allowed to gather eggs. But this is a kingdom-style Easter egg hunt. And that means that the more you gather, the more there is to share. None are to go into pockets. This is a kingdom Easter egg hunt, people. So when we say go, and only when we say go after the service, if you're a child or a teenager, or young at heart, you're allowed to gather the eggs which are hidden, some easily and some extremely hard, in the garden at the front. Then they're all going to be put together in a gigantic pile of glorious egginess to be shared out equally among those who are small. Do we all understand the rules? Excellent. Please stand. I don't know how this is going to work. Let's receive God's blessing together. God the Father, by whose love Christ was raised from the dead, open to you who believe the gates of everlasting life.
Amen. Amen.
God the Son, who in bursting from the grave has won a glorious victory, give you joy as you share the Easter faith. Amen. Amen. God the Holy Spirit, who filled the disciples with the life of the risen Lord, empower you and fill you with Christ's peace.
Amen. Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you and those whom you love and pray for this day and evermore. Amen.
is now for a time to extinguish this candle as a sign of us being sent into the world. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.